Hey guys, welcome to another PyTorch tutorial. I'm your host, Yujin Tang. So in the past few videos, we've been learning about recurrent neural networks, neural networks in general in PyTorch, playing around with some of the data. So in this one, we're gonna take a look at the LSTM network. So this is another type of recurrent neural network. If you'll remember the last time we worked on the RNN, we got somewhere around 80 something accuracy, and we had to train that for about 10 epochs to get that. So in the LSTM, this is different from the regular RNN because it has these kind of ways to forget and to decide what input that is seen, that is already seen, that is important. So I'm going to start doing this. So, and much of this we're going to start very similarly to the RNN and the CNN stuff. We did the imports. Now we have to get the data loaders. So let's get the data loaders in here. Oh, batch size. So we're going to define the batch size here. Let's just do 100. Cool. So batch size is one of the hyperparameters that we looked at. It is how many samples your network sees before it updates itself. I don't need to save this. Okay. So, I hope I didn't need to save that anyway. No, I don't think so. Anyway, we're going to go look at how to build the network now that we have trained this. Actually, first let's define some hyperparameters. So define hyperparams. So we already defined the batch size up there. A few other hyperparameters that we're going to be interested in defining are the sequence and the input length. So sequence len equals 28, input len equals 28. So this is because we're working with the MNIST fashion dataset again. Both the MNIST digits and the MNIST fashion dataset have 28 by 28 images, and that's why we have an input size of 28 and a sequence length of 28. Now we're also going to define the hidden size of our network, and a classic number here, we're just going to do 128. This is the number of, you know how neural networks, they kind of, you have these layers and they have these hidden layers. This is equivalent to the LSTM hidden layers. But we're really only going to do two layers in the LSTM. And then we're also going to define the number of classes here. So last time we haven't defined this, but that's because we have 10 classes and we know that, but it's actually good practice to define these for more customizability if you want to train your neural network on different inputs. So we've already defined batch size. Now we're going to also define the number of epochs. So this LSTM, already played around this. We actually only need a few epochs of training to get to 80 something. So let's get a 5. Then let's also define a learning rate. So last time we found that a good learning rate was in the hundredths. So we're gonna set this to 0.01. So these are gonna be our hyperparameters. And now we're gonna create an LSTM. So the first thing we do, just like last time, is we do an init function, which needs the self, as well as some of the hyperparameters we're gonna get put in here are the input size, the hidden size, the number of layers, the number of classes. So, see input len, hidden size, num classes, num layers. Yep. So now, like we have done before, we're going to call the super. This calls the NN modules super function. Oh, this needs to be capital N. And now we're gonna set the hidden size and the number of layers. Self.hiddenSize equals hidden size. Self.numLayers equals numLayer. Oops. Now we're going to define the LSTM and the output layer. So LSTM equals NN, the NN.LSTM of the input size, the input len, the hidden size, the number of layers, and the number of classes. We also need to define the output layer. So before we do that, let's also remember to, we actually don't need the num classes here. We're gonna batch first though. It's true. Self.output layer equals that linear hin size num classes, hin size num classes. So that's all we're gonna do for the LSTM's neural network. Now we need to define the forward function as we have defined in the other examples as well. So the forward function only requires one parameter, and that is x, the input. So unlike the RNN, we have to define the hidden states and the states of the cells, and those are just going to start as zero in our case. So the hidden states is the state of the hidden layers, basically. X.size. Zero self dot hidden size. Oops, that's not supposed to be a dot. That's supposed to be a, okay. And the cell states should be the exact same initialization. Now we need to get the output of the hidden layer. So out. So the LSTM actually gives a tuple as an output, the output and the hidden state, but we don't need the hidden state, so we're just gonna put it into a underscore variable, which basically says that we're using it as a temporary variable and we don't need it. Then we're gonna reshape the output before we use it into the output layer. So now out is gonna equal self.output layer. So we basically need to flatten this output. Except instead of using nn.flatten, we're going to reshape it using the way that we would reshape a tensor. Return out. Oops, out. And so that's it. That's building the LSTM. Now we're going to set the model. So model equals LSTM. What does it need again? Input len. Oops. Hidden size, num classes, and num layers. Okay, and we're gonna print our model so we can see what it looks like. Great, this is what our model is. It's an LSTM 28 with 128 hidden size of 128 and two layers, and then the output turns that into 128 into 10 layers, into 10 outputs, which is the number of classes available. Ooh, feeling a little bit burpy. Okay, so now let's define a loss function and an optimizer. Oops, loss func geez, equals, this one should be nn.crossEntropy. So there are other loss functions that we can use. This is just the one that we opt to use. Often the optimizer can be, did I not import optim? Oh, I forgot to import optim. Okay. Torch. Cool. So usually we do SGD. Model parameters and LR equals learning rate. Now there are other optimizers, and earlier actually, we'll see what happens when we use SGD. The earlier one that I was playing around with was Atom, and in that one, we got really high accuracy really quickly. So if this doesn't work out that well, we'll try that out and see if that is the difference. So that's actually another hyperparameter that we can adjust, that we can tune, is the optimizer. Also the loss function. We didn't tune these in the RNN fast tune, but we can learn about and tune these throughout these videos. And there are many, and I have an article about the Keras optimizers, which really just kind of goes through what the available optimizers in neural networks are in general. And it just kind of goes through how they work in Keras, but they work similarly in PyTorch. And what really matters is that you understand what the optimizers are kind of functionally doing. So now we're going to define the training function. The training function is going to take in the number of epochs, the models, and the loader. Number of epochs, the model, and the loader, train loader. So like the last time, we're just going to do the total steps equals len train load. Oops, train load. There we go. Ah, okay. So we need to basically create the same training function that we've been using. I'm going to recreate this from scratch for practice and so that you can follow along if you are coding along with me. And unlike the other ones, we're actually not going to be doing the exact range num epochs. This is going to be slightly different because each time I like rewrite these, I learn a little bit more. In enumerate. Okay, let me just talk when I'm done. There we go. I learn a little bit more about the objects involved and how I use them or how to use them in each one. So we're going to reshape the images. So because we did the batch first, we need to reshape them into the right size. Oh, is that? Oh, okay. Reshape is a function of images. Yes, okay. yes, okay. So actually this is what you would do if you were running a GPU. I forgot. I'm not going to use a GPU. So the Mac uses, I'm on a Mac. The Mac uses this thing called MPS, which I actually haven't fully figured out yet, but I was playing around with GPUs. And if you have a CUDA, you can do to device, where device should be like CUDA or something like that. Or if it's Mac, it would be MPS. Now let's pass this forward into the model. So the output is going to equal what happens when we pass the model the images. And the loss function is going to be calculated equals from, I should take the loss function too, is going to be calculated from the outputs and the labels, output labels, there we go. Then we're going to backward pass where we zero the gradients and we pass it backwards and we step. So backward pass loss.backwards. I think it's backwards. Maybe it's backward. What did we use last time? Yeah, backward, okay. Optimizer.step. So you don't have to memorize all the functions and exactly how to do it, you just have to kind of understand how it works. So we're going to also say that every 100 epochs, we're going to display, if batch, we're going to display the current loss and how it's going. So print f epoch. Oh, sorry, this should actually be epic. Batch. Batch. Total steps. And then loss. Oh, sorry, this should actually be bash plus one. This should actually be epic plus one. Because, well, we as humans don't think zero. Lost item. I think it's... Well, I forgot. How do you define the... Ah, yes, okay. It's just this. Let's see, 4D. Is that not right? Is it... Ah. Oh, sorry. Probably 4F. So yeah, that should wrap up the trainer, and now we can train. And notice that unlike the other time, we're not doing any validation steps. We're just going to train, and then we're going to look at the accuracy. And this is not always best practice, but for this toy example of training on the Fashion MNIST dataset, what the point of this video is to teach you just how to train one of these models, how to create one, and then train a model. And it's also for me to kind of get more versed in creating these as well. But it's just for that, and it's not to necessarily show you how this works in production. We'll take a look at how some of the stuff works in production later when we look at some of the cloud things. Num-epics. What else do we have? Model train data loader. What? Train data loader, and then loss function. Cool. Ah! Images. Hour. Where did I do this? Here we go. So I'm going to pause this while it trains, and then we're going to come back and we're going to take a look at the accuracy afterwards. Okay, welcome back. So we've trained 5 epics. All of the batches are done, and we've gotten to a pretty good loss function. So actually, while I was while we were paused, I actually set up the atom and the SGD just to kind of, you know, do a different optimizer in, and I did notice that Atom has a much better optimization than SGD, so it is also a more complex function. So anyway, we're going to, and by the way, initializing Atom in PyTorch is the same as initializing SGD. All you do is type Atom instead. Now let's take a look at what this loss function translates into actually predicted outputs. So let's get the predicted outputs. Oops. Test data. I think test data loader. Do we have the test output? Do I have the test data? Okay. Test data, I think. We have to get the test output. So test output equals model dot predict. Forgot how to do this. Next. So first what we're going to do is we want to separate images and labels. So images, test images, test labels equals test data loader. Let me just check here. Yes, okay. That doesn't seem to be right. Test labels. Okay, cool. So this gets us to the next 100 things in the data loader. So the next 100 inputs in the data loader. So we can test all of them, but really we can kind of also just take a look at what each one is. So actually, why don't we do this? So model, okay, I forgot how to separate them. Here we go. Well, we're gonna test them a different way. So there are multiple ways that you can test these. So we're gonna get the images and the labels, and we're going to compare them to the test output. So test output. So test output is where we run the model. Model test images dot new label 128. So we're gonna put them. We're doing this so that our model sees them as the 128 to 28. Now let's do the predicted layer, and that's gonna be the max of the output and one, and it's gonna be. Okay, so this is gonna be an interesting one. So let's take a look at predicted first, and then I'm gonna show you. This is just an interesting like thing. So look at this, okay? Now we're gonna turn this into something that actually makes sense. So first we're gonna get the second, this stuff, which is the predicted, actual predictions. And now we're going to compare these to the correct. So percentage correct equals 0. Percentage correct equals plus. Equals 0 plus 1. If predicted I equals test output, test labels I for I in range 100. Can I not do this? No. Okay, so let's do this then. Correct equals 1 for I in range 100 if predicted. So I think I needed to write that backwards. I don't know why I can like write it. Like it makes sense to me to write it this way, but not the other way. Anyway, percentage correct equals sum correct. Percentage correct 0.9, so 90 out of 100. So in 5 epics we got to a 90% correct one, so that's pretty good. We can of course test it on all of these by basically getting all of them in instead of just using this. So my feeling is that we can use this shape to do that, to iterate through all the data loaders to reshape them, and then to Let's just do it. Let's just see what happens here. Test data loader. Test loss equals. This is Adam. Huh? What did I do here? Loss function. Loss function, yes, okay. Loss func. Flow object assigned variable. Okay, so mess this up again. For x, y in data loader, correct plus equals. Something. Do this. Okay, let's see the test loop with the loss train data loader. Sorry, the test data loader. The model. Oh my god. Python. The model. The loss function. And Adam. Okay, 87.5 on for the entire data set. Still better than what we had before. Anyway, that's pretty much the introduction to how you can create an LSTM and train it in PyTorch. Thanks for watching, and remember to subscribe. Peace out, guys. See you next time.